Middle right, at the end of the image train, you can see the camera on my refractor telescope here. That's the Player One Uranus-C. I've been using the Player One Uranus-C camera for about a year now. And to be honest, using this camera, I haven't felt any particular compulsion to so-called upgrade in all that time. I mean, that camera pretty much lives on the telescope. There's no reason really to switch it out. The camera is uncooled, and yet it performs really well. So well, in fact, that in another video, I argued that I think that for many of us, the need for cooled cameras is starting to fade away. I don't think we're quite there yet for every application, but for many things we do in astrophotography, yes. At the end of that video, one person posted on the YouTube channel that, well, look at the back of your camera, you can clearly see a cooling unit there. I'm not quoting her, it's something like that. Well, it's not a cooling unit, at least it's not a Peltier thermoelectric cooling unit, which is basically like a mini freezer. That's what Player One refers to as an active cooling unit, which is not much different than the fan that sits over the processor on your CPU. You can see it in this image here, mounted onto the back of a Uranus-C camera. It can't make the sensor any cooler than the ambient temperature, but it can at least help the sensor shed some excess heat. I'm not honestly entirely sure that I even need it. I usually have it on when I use the telescope during summer nights, and it probably helps a little bit. But on another astrophotography channel, a fellow who goes by Lucomatico notes that he used this Uranus-C camera without any kind of cooling at all on a 30 degrees Celsius night in the UK. And you know what? I believe him entirely. The camera does remarkably well, whatever the temperature, and in a variety of shooting conditions. So much so, that presently this is my favorite camera. Now before I go in any deeper into this topic, I want to give you a little bit of background about me. I come at astrophotography from the perspective of a person who has done professional photography as part of how I put myself through university and made a living earlier in my life. And I know when people are new at photography, they tend to have this belief, perspective, that the way to get better is to throw money at photography. And the reality is, well, professionals tend to use good equipment, that's true, but they don't just keep throwing money at problems to solve the problems. I mean, a higher degree of tech doesn't necessarily make you a better photographer. They learn to make the best out of what they have and work around technical difficulties as they come up. So I've been involved in photography for so long that that's my general approach to those things. I'm not one of those persons who's just going to go out and throw more and more money buying more and more gizmos and gadgets, which really makes me the wrong person, or perhaps the right person, to do anything like a product review. Because I'm not the kind of person that's going to tell you, go out and buy, that'll make you shoot better. I just want you to enjoy astrophotography. That's always been my goal here when I do videos on astrophotography on this channel. Just get out and enjoy it. Take some nice pictures. If you're interested in the science of astronomy, learn from those images. You don't need to spend $1 billion on gear to do so. So anyway, with all that said, I'll very happily say that this camera is my camera of choice for almost everything. The camera just simply is excellent, and it only cost about $400. That's an amazing price for a camera this capable. Let's take a look at the specs. I'm taking the specs right off of Player One's own website, drawing from their own images. I hope they don't mind. They didn't ask me to do this review. I just really like their cameras. I have a Player One Uranus-C for my primary imaging camera, and I'm using their Xena M for my guiding camera, and I'm just so impressed with their cameras. So I'm just doing this review because I think they're great, and I think it's an affordable way for new and aspiring astrophotographers to get into astrophotography without having to take out a second mortgage on your home. So when you flip the camera over, you can see that the sensor follows a pretty standard, roughly 16:9 sensor ratio. And Player One is using the Sony IMX585 sensor on this camera. There is no mono option for the Uranus model. It only comes as a color camera. And up until recently, this camera was only available uncooled. Though in the last few months, Player One has come out with a pretty well bargain price version of this camera that they refer to as the Pro version because it is cooled. And I have nothing against it, I just don't honestly think the cooling is necessary. The specs of the camera are quite impressive. The camera has a gain possibility of about 0 to 550 with a unity gain at around 210. At 210, readout noise drops to about 1/4 what it was with the gain below 210. And increasing gain even further from there does not make a whole lot of difference in readout noise, not unless you go way up the scale, and even then you only lose about 30%. It's really an impressively low-noise sensor. The camera has an impressive full well depth of 46,708 at zero gain, and an impressive 4,000 full well depth at unity gain. And we have a dynamic range of 12.651 at zero gain, which drops only to 10.14 at 209 gain. And then at 210, where one crosses over into unity gain, we climb back up to an 11.891 dynamic range, almost as high as at zero gain, and that is incredibly impressive. Dynamic range, to me, in particular, is one of the most important aspects of a camera's abilities, because it shows the range of shading that a camera can capture between full dark and full brightness. And if you're somewhat mystified by all these numbers and what they mean, we'll go into them in a future video. I know there's a lot to learn. I'm always saying that, aren't I? We'll go into them in a future video. But to get really deeply into the technical meanings of these specifications, we need to take a full video. In fact, one might say we could take a full video on any one of those technical specs. I think the light response indicated on the QE curve, though, is especially interesting. Because when I use a color camera for astrophotography, I want to see a fair bit of crossover between the blue, green, and red channels. That's actually advantageous. You know, as we've talked about in previous videos, there is this myth that there is not a lot of green light in space. There's plenty of green light in space, especially when we understand that the primary colors are not red, green, and blue. They are red, yellow, and blue. And in a color camera, the bare layer is capturing all light between red and blue on the green channel. And that's a lot of different frequencies of light. So heavy crossover, especially of the green channel over into blue and red, tells me that the green channel is seeing a lot of use, even if we're looking at a target where you don't find a lot of green light, such as certain nebulae, especially those nebulae are being imaged using dual or tri-band filters. So when I see this IMX 585 QE curve diagram here, what it tells me is the entire sensor is being put to good use when imaging astrophotography subjects. And the only exception to that would be if we were using narrowband filters, which, as we talked about in a previous video, you should not really do with color cameras. Narrowband imaging is a technique that works best with, and is made for, monochrome cameras. But something else that also intrigues me a great deal about the capacity of this camera is the red channel goes well beyond 700 nanometers, deep into the infrared. If you were so inclined, you are well capable of capturing infrared imagery with this camera. All in all, we'll just say that these are very impressive specs. Actually, I didn't want to go too deeply into these specs, so I'm not going to take this any further at this time. I'm a big believer that the proof is in the pudding, as they say. So what I want to do now is show you some of the imagery that I've taken with the Uranus-C camera since I bought the thing back in 2022. Because in the end, you can't argue with the results. This is the Ghostbush star cluster. It was the first image I ever took with the Uranus-C when I got it. And I'll be honest, it was a miserable winter night, dead cold, and lots of high-flying, fast-moving clouds. And I only had about 2 hours on this subject before I lost it behind the clouds. I know, it's not a terribly impressive image in and of itself, except I was pretty impressed with how effectively it caught so little light. Especially given at the time I was just using that little 81mm Williams optic refractor. A few weeks later, when good weather reappeared and I had a chance to get the camera properly configured to the telescope and working smoothly with Nina, I shot this image. This was the result of spending all night on the Bubble Nebula and the Cassiopeia Salt and Pepper Cluster. I was delighted to be able to shoot both these interesting subjects so closely together, especially since the star cluster is often drowned out by its eye-catching companion, the Bubble Nebula. As you can see, there's a lot of other nebulous gas in the region showing up as faint cloud. But the Bubble Nebula is such an interesting target, and I decided to crop out the star cluster and just focus on that, and use a few interesting color mapping and stretching techniques to really bring out the beauty and the wonder of the Bubble Nebula. So this is the same image, one night of imagery, caught and cropped from the Uranus-C camera. Also bear in mind, there's no cooling in this image. This was shot in latter spring. The nights were still cool, but they were starting to get warmer, somewhere between 12 and 15 degrees Celsius. It wasn't warm enough yet that I was bothering to use the active cooling fan either. This is just the camera operating on its passive cooling. About a week later, on another clear night, I was able to take this shot of the Witch's Broom of the Veil Nebula. This is a fairly dim, not too dim, but fairly dim target, a beautiful target that appears in the northern hemisphere, the remnants of a star that went supernova thousands of years ago. superheated gases left over from that supernova flying off into space. To me, it is one of the most beautiful nebulae to be seen in the northern sky, and I was deeply impressed with the ability of the Uranus-C camera, such an inexpensive astro camera, to capture the vivid colors and the luminous beauty of this incredible nebula. The next night, since clear skies were continuing, which is rare in Nova Scotia to get more than two or three clear nights in a row, but the next night I was able to capture this image. This is Bode's galaxy on the left and the Cigar galaxy on the right. To get these galaxies zoomed in this much, or apparently zoomed in, I had to crop the sensor a considerable amount, I'd say maybe two-thirds, and then work a little magic with PixInsight and Noise and Blur Exterminator. Nonetheless, even the best software can only work with the information that's available. And this little Uranus-C camera captured a great deal of detail. Those little 2.9 micron pixels are great for picking up tiny details within an astrophotography image. I know smaller pixels make more noise, but 2.9 microns seems to be a kind of sweet spot, giving a great balance between information and noise. A couple weeks later, during another night of clear skies, I was able to capture this image of the Iris Nebula. The detail that's available in the image is amazing, given that I've cropped out about 90% of the sensor. Here I'll show you. Here's the original image. Once again, the advantage of those small 2.9 micron pixels really stands out here. They are able to capture a great deal of detail in a small space, allowing for heavy but useful cropping of the Uranus-C sensor. Around that time, a supernova was discovered in the Pinwheel Galaxy. But here in wet Nova Scotia, you can be sure that if there is something interesting going on in the sky, there are going to be clouds. And it wasn't until about 3 weeks after the supernova appeared that the clouds finally broke and I had a chance to properly image the galaxy. And so, like so many of us, I spent a night on the Pinwheel. And this is the result, with about 80% of the sensor cropped. And about 10 days later, when we had another few days of clear skies, I spent a night on the Cygnus Wall. This is a nebula that is so complex and beautiful, I think it's hard to take a bad shot of it. But one of the things I really like about shooting astrophotography with a color camera is seeing true colors, or at least colors the way the human eye would perceive them. And this is a true color image of the Cygnus Wall, having spent one night imaging the subject. And here is the same Cygnus Wall, also shot with the Uranus-C camera, but with the histogram reprocessed to bring out the colors hidden in the Cygnus Wall, giving us an effect very similar to what one would get with narrowband imaging. And all this with a $400 planetary camera. This is an image I'm especially fond of. This is the Trifid Nebula. I removed the stars. I just thought this image was so incredibly interesting without the stars. It wasn't a great night. The first quarter, maybe third of the night, was cloudy. And it was also high summer here in Nova Scotia. Lots of humidity in the air, relatively poor seeing, and very short nights lasting barely 6 hours of nautical dark. And even so, the Uranus-C managed to pull this off. And if you'd like to see the same nebula with stars, there it is. There's also a loose star cluster there on the left, known as the Webb's Cross. All this from about 4 hours of imaging with an 80mm telescope, technically an 81mm telescope, and the Uranus-C Player One behind a ZWO duoband filter. I could go on, but this video is getting kind of long, isn't it? So here's one more image, one that I think is especially impressive because I shot it in under 2 hours. It had been cloudy for weeks and weeks here in Nova Scotia, about 3 weeks to be specific, and we finally had a couple clear nights, and darn if I wasn't going to make use of it. But even though the meteorologist was predicting clear skies, it ended up raining till almost 1 a.m. When it finally quit raining, I hurried outside and set up my mount and my telescope on the pier where I'm building an observatory, and it took about 30-45 minutes to get the thing properly aligned and ready to go. And because I'm above the 45th parallel in latitude, and it's summer, nights are still relatively short, so I had only about 2 hours until nautical dawn. So with so little time available, I chose a relatively bright and easy target, the Pleiades. With a magnitude of positive 1.2, the Pleiades is fairly dim to the human eye, but relatively bright to a telescope. Still, 2 hours isn't all that long to shoot anything unless you're shooting something very bright like a planet or the moon. Nonetheless, in just about 2 hours, my little 81mm telescope mounted on a Skywatcher EQ6 mount using only the Uranus-C camera and that ZWO dual band filter was able to capture this image of the Pleiades. These gorgeous blues and the ethereal gases wafting between the stars. To me, I find this to be just one of the most pleasing images I've ever shot. So there's my review of the Player One Uranus-C camera. The specs, the numbers, they're important. And at the same time, the numbers be damned. The proof is in the outcome. So my review of this camera is it is superb. And I'll tell you, I haven't even talked about the Xena M, that my Player One guide camera. But one of the things that I find to be pretty consistent with Player One cameras is their cameras actually do what the makers say they're going to do. Player One doesn't upsell them. The specs you see are the specs you get. So that's my thoughts on Player One cameras. I intend to keep using these two Player Ones, and I'm hoping in the near future to maybe get one of the Poseidons, or perhaps the Aries camera. I love their cameras. Their engineers take already really good sensors and work miracles with them. Well, they do really good stuff with them anyway. Very capable cameras, and very good value for the money.